Okay, we're on with Romans. Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. In that section, Paul celebrates the fact that God has justified and reconciled his enemies through the death of one man, Jesus Christ, and can therefore be counted on to save them from the coming wrath. And then in verses 12 to 21 of chapter 5, he makes the point that it's not as strange as it seems that one man can have such a significant effect on so many people. Because here he has in 1 through 11 this tremendous effect of Christ, and then in 12 to 21, that's not as strange as it may seem. There's an analog in the case of Adam, in that just as there existed a death-producing connection between Adam and his own, so there exists a life-producing connection between Christ and his own. So that's what I see him doing, the big picture of what he's doing in verses 12 through 21. Then in chapter 6, Paul addresses the Christian's freedom from bondage to sin, which is brought up by something that he says at the end of... Hey, Tort. It's brought up by something at the end of chapter 5. Now, I'd read 6, 1 to 14, and just started to talk about it. I want to read it again. I'll repeat some of what I said just because reading it, I want to pick that back up. So bear with me for some repetition, and then we'll carry on from there. But chapter 6, verses 1 to 14, he says, "What then shall we say? Should we continue in sin so that grace may increase? Absolutely not. We who died to sin, how shall we still live in it? Or do you not know that as many as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore we were buried together with him through baptism into his death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so also we might walk in newness of life. For if we've been united with the likeness of his death, then also we will be united with the likeness of his resurrection, knowing that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be nullified, that we might no longer serve sin as slaves. For the one who died has been pronounced righteous from sin. But if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, no longer dies. Death no longer exercises lordship over him. For what he died to sin once and for all. But what he lives to God. So also you must consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but living to God in Christ Jesus. Do not then let sin reign in your mortal body, so that you obey its passions, nor present your members to sin as weapons of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those living from the dead, and your members to God as weapons of righteousness. For sin will not exercise lordship over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace." So Paul here, he says in chapter 6, he'd mentioned before that grace superabounded in the face of this increase of sin that was occasioned by the law that he mentions in chapter 5, verse 20. Now, having said that, some people might think, well, look, the implication of that, Paul is saying that we should remain in sin, that we should remain under sin's control so that grace may increase. I mean, if God's glorified and forgiving and giving us grace, you're saying that in light of grace, grace superabounds in light of this increase in sin. Well, are you saying that we should stay in sin? And Paul says, of course I'm not. Just as he said in chapter 3, verse 8, his response is nonsense. He says, absolutely not. It's totally inconsistent for Christians, those who've died to sin. And as I said last week, meaning died to sin's loss. Died to sin's detriment, having been separated from sin's power, out of sin's control. It's inconsistent for Christians who are those who've had that happen to continue to live under sin's control. This is completely inconsistent. To think otherwise is to ignore the fact that our sharing in Christ's death through baptism was so that we, like Christ, might rise from that death, he says, to walk, to live in newness of life, meaning to live a life in a new state. You see, in a state that is marked by the realities of the new age. Christ walks in newness of life. See, since his resurrection, he walks in newness of life. He lives in a new state. He lives in a state that is marked by the new age reality of an immortal body. See, having been raised from the dead, death no longer exercises lordship over him. He walks in that new state, and we rise from sharing in his death through baptism to walk in newness of life, and that we live in a new state, one that's marked by the new age reality, such as empowerment by God's Spirit. You see, so this idea, we are to live in a different state. Things are not the same as they were. There has been a significant and radical transformation and change when we go through dying with Christ in baptism. We rise to walk in newness of life, to walk in a new state of existence, one that is new and that it's characterized by these new age realities. And a very significant one is this empowerment of the Spirit, as we'll see in Romans chapter 7, verse 6, Romans chapter 8. See, he says then, for if we've been united with the likeness of Christ's death through baptism, then we will also be united with the likeness of his resurrection. The one follows the other. You see, the one follows the other. We know, he says, that our old man was crucified with Jesus in our sharing in his death. The death he died once for all. And as I said last week, this old man is the man of the old age, the man who was under the tyranny of sin and death, the person who was under condemnation. It is us in Adam. That's who it is who died. The old man is the one who exists in Adam. The new man is the one who exists in Christ. And right when we ended, I was making the point that this verse and Colossians chapter 3, verses 9 and 10, you see that they make clear that the Christian has ceased to be old man and has become new man. And yet we have these texts like Ephesians chapter 4, 22 to 24, that commands Christians to put off the old man and to put on the new man. And you say, well, how do those things go together? And that's right when we ended, when I was telling you that. See, I think the idea is that as long as we live in this overlap of ages, the new man that we are in Christ continues to be subject to the influences of the power of the old age. And that person has to continually resist them. In other words, we have to live like the new creature that we are. Or as the quote I gave you from Douglas Moo, the way he puts it, what we were in Adam is no more, but until heaven the temptation to live in Adam always remains. And so I think that's how to understand that. Now, this participation of our old man in the crucifixion of Christ has the purpose of nullifying or neutralizing the body as the body of sin. See, the purpose of nullifying or neutralizing the body as the body of sin, meaning the body under sin's dominion, a body that is used in the service of sin. This is explained in the clause in verse 6, that last clause there, where it says that we might no longer serve sin as slaves. I mean, do you see the ethical component of this? I'm going to talk about this a lot for the rest of this class and in the weeks ahead. But one of the things I think that in Christianity we get the idea, which is incorrect, that Christianity is purely forensic. That the only difference is that I am now forgiven. Before Christ, I was guilty. Now I have been forgiven, but I'm the same person in a new situation. That's not true. Yes, you have been forgiven, but you are a new person in a new situation. And we underplay the transforming power of the Spirit in the life of the Christian. And so Paul won't let us do that. And you'll see as we go through. But this is what you're seeing here. This idea where he says here that we might no longer serve sin as slaves. And one reason that our having died with Christ, our having participated in his death in our baptism, one reason that that's to have this radical effect on our relationship to sin is given in verse 7, where it says, the one who's died with Christ in baptism has been pronounced righteous or acquitted from sin. Now, many translate this here, freed from sin, meaning freed from its power. The normal use of the word is this idea of pronounced righteous or acquitted, and I think that makes sense here. I think it makes sense here that we've been released from the dreadful condemnation that our sinning has justly incurred. So the only appropriate response is that we flee sin. You know, I was thinking like the appropriate response of somebody who's a terminally ill lung cancer patient who's miraculously healed. The only appropriate, fitting response for that is that he flees smoking. Does that mean he will? But that's the fitting response. That's the sane response. That's the appropriate response, is that somebody who's been released from that doesn't go back and embrace that which slaughtered them. And so to me it makes sense that this is at least here he's talking about that there's one reason that our having died with Christ through his baptism is to have that radical effect on our relationship to sin, is because in that we were freed from it, in the sense of pronounced righteous from it. You see, so we ought to flee and run from it. Now, since it's true that we died with Christ, that's the sense of this, but if we died. The sense is, since it's true that we died with Christ and thus have been pronounced righteous from sin, he says, we believe. Now, that points to a promise, you see. He says, we believe that we will live, which is a future tense. And there was a future tense that was used in verse 5. He says, we will live with Jesus. In verse 5, he's talking about walking in newness of life. So I think it's there talking about we'll rise and walk in newness of life now. Here, I think it's an actual future of the eschaton. When he says that we will live with Jesus, I think is most likely meaning that we'll live with him as resurrected people, as sharers in his resurrection in that sense when he returns. And this belief that we'll do that's rooted in our knowledge that the resurrected Christ is immortal. That he's not going to wind up, he wasn't raised and will live for a while like the other cases in Scripture where people were brought back to life. That's not what this is. You've had resuscitations, you've had people raised from the dead, but this is an era-changing rising from the dead. This is resurrection. Death no longer has lordship over Jesus, you see. So he's no longer under the power of death, because the death that he died, he says it was a death to sin. It was a death that separated him from the power of sin that is manifested in the death penalty that sin brings. And that one time, sin separating and thus death defeating death was for all who will share in it. So Jesus is no longer subject to death. He was subject to death. He died. But having been raised from the dead, he's no longer subject to death. He is immortal. And you and I will share in that with him. Now, though his death was to sin, Paul says that the life Christ lives is to God. I got to say, I was telling Meg this morning, I've said it to her more than one time, Paul is like really deep. Now, I understand it's the Spirit of God through Paul. But Paul is, you know, Paul is not a lightweight. And when you hop in Paul's stuff, well, it's all the Scripture, really. But I mean, when you wrestle with it, you're just going, Paul, what is this? You know? But I think Paul says here that Christ's death was to sin, the life that he lives to God is to God. His sin bearing for us is finished. You know, as Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, he was made sin for us. His sin bearing is finished. His subjection to the power of sin as sin bearer is over. He now lives to God in that, having finished his role as sin bearer, he lives forever free of that temporary intrusion of our sin into his relationship with the Father. You remember, my God, why have you forsaken me? Well, why is that? That's because he's functioning as sin bearer. You see, but he's now finished with that. So he's finished with that, and he now lives forever free of that temporary intrusion of our sin into his relationship with his Father. So also, we as Christians, he says, we are to constantly regard ourselves, to consider ourselves, to think of ourselves as being dead to sin but alive to God. We have to continually lay hold of that reality. We must no longer see ourselves in our relationship to sin as we were outside of Christ. This idea that you come to Christ, you're baptized into Christ and share in his death, and you get up and you're the same person, but you're only forgiven now, isn't biblical. It is not biblical. You are a radically different person, and you must live consistently with that. It is not some small matter when we call people to holy and righteous living. That's not, oh, you don't want to talk about that. That's legalistic. No, that's Christianity. I am to live to the honor of God, and I've been empowered by the Spirit of God to do it. I'm no longer a slave to sin. I've been changed. And we have to see that. And we have to stop excusing. Oh, no, don't worry. You know what? That's just go ahead. Live any way you want. Aren't you glad that you've got the great sin cleanser in the sky? That's not it. You and I are to live to the glory of God, and we've been empowered to do that. We've been empowered to do that. We have to continually lay hold of that reality. We must no longer see ourselves in relationship to sin as we were outside of Christ. We must see ourselves as having died in Christ to sin's loss, to sin's detriment, as having been freed from sin's claim on us, and as being in relationship with God that no longer suffers from sin's alienating effect. We have to see ourselves that way. Hold on to that truth. Consider ourselves that way. And then the practical side of that, the practical side of seeing ourselves as dead to sin but alive to God, is that we must not let, we must not allow. Do you see your part in that? We must not let command from the Spirit of God. We must not let allow sin to reign in our bodies, sin to rule our mortal bodies. We must not offer. Do you see your part in that? You must not offer your bodily members to sin to be used as weapons of unrighteousness. Spirit of God speaking to me, speaking to you, saying, do not, you must not allow, you must not allow ourselves to do that. Allow sin to rule us, or offer our bodily members to be used as weapons of righteousness. See, now that we understand ourselves, now that we see ourselves, and we hold to that truth, and we consider ourselves dead to sin but alive to God, we must constantly avoid using our bodies in the service of sin. Our bodies, this is us. This is us. And so we have to constantly avoid using our bodies in the service of sin. We must not, for example, use our eyes to view pornography. We must not do that. Take our eyes and use them as instruments of sin. God says, don't do that. Now, do we yield to God or do we rebel against God? Do we say, no, I'm not going to do that? Okay, this idea of offering our bodies, we must not use our eyes to view pornography, our ears to listen to obscene music, our hands to steal, our tongues to lie, or our private parts to engage in sexual immorality. He says, you are changed, renewed, freed, and you cannot take this instrument and use it in service of sin. You are to use it rather as instruments of righteousness. That is what this body is to be a tool of. It is to be a tool of righteousness, not sin. We're to offer ourselves in service to God as those who through union with Christ have been rescued. Those who've been given spiritual life from the state of death that we were in. So we're to offer our bodily members to God to be used as weapons of righteousness. That is how we're to conduct ourselves. That is how we're to live. You say, well, but you know, the world's got an awful lot of stuff to offer that I want to engage in. What does the Spirit of God say? You and I are people of God. We say, what do you want of me? Okay, this is how I'm going to live to glorify you. Thank you for redeeming me. Thank you for rescuing me. Thank you for changing me. Everything I have is yours. I'll offer my body in service of righteousness that you might be glorified. I won't use it as an instrument of sin. Douglas Moo says in his commentary, in characterizing the body as mortal, Paul is reminding us that the same body that has been severed from its servitude to sin, chapter 6, verse 6, is nevertheless the body that still participates in the weakness, suffering, and dissolution of this age. Until we are fully redeemed, chapter 8, verse 23, and put on immortality, 1 Corinthians 15, 53, that's until the consummation. We will continue to be subject to the influences of this age, and the believer must not let these influences hold sway. The Christian is no longer body of sin or body of death, but he or she is still mortal body. And I think that's important. You see, you and I do live in this overlap of ages, but we have been set free. The Christian can be bold and confident in this war against sin because sin's dominion has been broken. Its dominion has been broken. We're promised that sin will not exercise lordship over us. Now, what are you going to do with that? There it is. You see, for sin will not exercise lordship over you. Verse 14. We have been changed. We have been empowered. This doesn't mean that you won't sin. Right? I mean, you live inside you, right? It doesn't mean you won't sin. That'll only be true when Jesus returns. It means sin will not be our controlling power. We will stumble, but we will not live in sin. We will be in a battle with sin. It doesn't dominate us and rule over us so that we're its stooge. You see? So there's a difference there. Do you see that difference? And so that's what Paul is talking about. Paul says in verse 14 that the reason sin will not exercise lordship over us is that we're not under law, but under grace. And I put the article in there because I think that's what he's talking about, as you'll see. Not under law, but under grace. By under law and under grace, he's contrasting the old and new covenants. That's what he means by under law and under grace. He's contrasting the old and new covenants. Not only did sin use the commands of the Mosaic law to arouse sinful passions, as we'll see in chapter 7, verse 5, which, by the way, I just find it beautiful. Here is sin, Paul says in 7:5, it uses the commands of the law to stimulate sin and to arouse sinful passions. But God, what does God do? God is able to account for sin's wicked work and then to use that and use the Mosaic law and incorporate that into his purpose of having the law serve as a trainer to lead people to Christ, as he says in Galatians chapter 3, verses 23 to 25, because it highlighted the need for mercy. So here we have sin using the law to stimulate. Sin's over here going, yeah, yeah, disobey, do all these things. God incorporates that, and he says, okay, the law is going to be the trainer to lead people, the people, to Christ, because what you're doing over here is going to show them the absolute need for mercy. You see, you see all the time evil trying to get over on God, and God just swallows it up. He just defeats it at every turn. But anyway, here you have, so under law and under grace, he's contrasting the old and new covenants. Not only did sin use the commands of the Mosaic law to arouse sinful passions, but the Holy Spirit's transforming power to live for God was not generally available under the old covenant. See, to be under grace is to be under the new covenant, in which we've been separated from sin's power by dying to sin in Christ and being empowered by the Holy Spirit to live for God. Let me read you a couple things here. This is Colin Cruz, and I see he's almost running out of room. He says, to be under law means to live under the regime of the Mosaic law. To be under that set, that pact. It is to live under the regime of the Mosaic law, under the old covenant, where the law was something written on tables of stone. And to be under grace is to live under the new covenant, where the law is written on the human heart. What was impossible under the regime of the Mosaic law, the fulfillment of the law's own demands because of humanity's weakness, is made possible under the new covenant because of the renewing and transforming power of the Spirit. Chapter 8, 3 and 4, Galatians 3, 23, 25, 4, 1, 7, 5, 18. While believers who live under the new covenant of grace no longer live under the Mosaic law as a regime, and this is what I've talked about, you know, not under the set of laws, this does not mean they're free to flout the moral imperatives found in the law, for these are the moral standards required of humankind by God himself. In fact, in those who walk by the Spirit, the just requirement, the eternal moral desires of God, of the law is, I have a typo there, the just requirement of the law is fulfilled. For as Paul says in 13:9, the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other command there may be, are summed up in the one command, love your neighbor as yourself. Galatians 5:14. And of course, love is included in the fruit of the Spirit. So I think this is an important thing to see, you know, what Paul is saying here, Thomas Schreiner, about this idea, you're not under law, but under grace, is contrasting the covenants. There's been a tremendous shift here. Schreiner says, Paul's point is that Israel did not keep the law as long as they were under the law, that is the Mosaic covenant. Now that believers are under the power of grace, they are enabled to keep the moral norms. See, does that mean all these things of the Mosaic law are applicable? No. All of those ritualistic things and the things that were peculiarly covenantal, as I've talked about, no, but there are things in there about how you're to love and how you're to treat and not to murder and to respect your parents and all of those things, you see, that are also part of the Mosaic law. It says, now that believers are under the power of grace, they're enabled to keep the moral norms of the law by the power of the Holy Spirit. Romans 8:4. This is precisely what both Jeremiah 31:31-34, and Ezekiel foresaw occurring when the new covenant became a reality. Isn't that right? Didn't Jeremiah and didn't Ezekiel see about a transformed person where the law is now on the heart? I'm going to remove your heart of stone. I'm going to give you a heart of flesh. I'm going to put a spirit within you that is different. And we act like we're the same person on that side of the baptistry as we were over here. Then we don't understand. We don't understand what God has given us in Christ. We have reduced it to simply a forensic forgiveness. And as wonderful as that is, that's not the whole story. That's not the whole story. We are different people. New people in a new situation. But as I've already indicated, even though we as Christians are empowered to obey these ethical norms in a new way. That's what he's talking about. We have been given the Spirit of God, and we live in a new plane. We live in a new plane, but still we live in the overlap of ages. We do not yet, you know, that's a phrase, now and not yet. We do not yet do so perfectly until the Lord returns. We live in the overlap of the old and new ages, in which we possess a down payment on the fullness of the life to come. And I've gone through in the past before and said, you know, we're adopted, but that's now and that's future. And listed all of these things now, but there's a future aspect to it. So we are participants in this. We have a foretaste of this full life, but on that day, our sanctification will be completed, finalized, when we who are now being transformed into the image of Jesus, as Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 3:18, isn't that right? Aren't we being transformed? Aren't we, you know, this is the graph like this. I understand it goes up and down, but the trend is upward. We're being transformed by the power of God's Spirit more and more into the image of Jesus Christ. And see, we who are doing that, it will be completed when He returns, and we will be like Him, as it says in 1 John chapter 3, verse 2. We will not live forever struggling, you see? But we have to understand that we are different now. Douglas Moo says here, the paragraph that began with the question, should we remain in sin in order that grace may increase? You remember that was the charge they're saying? He says, ends with the glad tidings that we're under grace in order that sin may be overcome. You see, that sin may be overcome. That is our calling. That is what we've been called to, and we're empowered to do it. All right, he goes on. Chapter 6, verse 15 to 23. Guys who talk a lot need water. What then? Should we sin because we're not under the law but under grace? Absolutely not. Do you not know that you are slaves to whom you present yourselves as slaves in obedience? To whom you obey? Whether of sin that leads to death or of obedience that leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God that though you were slaves of sin, you obeyed from the heart the pattern of teaching to which you were delivered, and having been freed from sin, were enslaved to righteousness. I speak in human terms because of the weakness of your flesh. For just as you presented your members as slaves to uncleanness and to lawlessness, leading to lawlessness, so also now present your members as slaves to righteousness, leading to sanctification. For when you were slaves of sin, you were free with respect to righteousness. Therefore, what fruit did you have then? Things of which you are now ashamed, for the end of those things is death. But now, having been freed from sin and enslaved to God, you have your fruit leading to sanctification, and the end is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Yeah, that's how I feel. I feel like just reading these things, you know, to say these things is just, you know, something. All right, having addressed the charge, you remember Paul addressed the charge that his gospel implies that Christians should sin because doing so increases God's forgiving. You know, that was the idea coming from chapter 5, verse 20. The idea is, well, if God forgives and He's glorified in that, then are you saying that we should keep on sinning? He says, no, that's crazy. But having addressed that, he now tackles the notion that his gospel leads to sinning through its claim that Christians are not subject to that body of commands known as the Mosaic Law. And Paul shows that that concern is rooted in a false dichotomy. That concern, listen, Paul, if you're saying that they don't have to be under this body of commands, under the Mosaic Covenant, that set of commands there, well, then you're promoting lawlessness. And Paul shows that's rooted in a false dichotomy. The alternative is not Judaism or immorality. That's not the alternative. One can be moral apart from Judaism, and for Christians, That's the only choice. That's the only choice. Paul says that if you act like something slave, it's the same thing as being its slave. You become a de facto slave. If you act like something slave, it's the same as being its slave. And that's true whether you act like a slave of sin, which leads to death, or whether you act like a slave of obedience, which leads to righteousness. And those are the only two choices. You know, I remember Bob Dylan had a song many years ago. You got to serve somebody. It might be the devil or it might be the Lord, but you got to serve somebody. And that's it. And those are the choices that you have. Now, this is the same idea, I think, in John chapter 8, verse 34, where the Lord said, every person who is committing sin, taking it as a present progressive, every person who is committing sin is a slave to sin. In that act, they are serving sin. You're giving yourself to sin. You're acting like sin's servant when you're doing that. But thanks be to God that though Christians, he says in verse 17, were slaves to sin. They were slaves to sin. You know, I always think about when I'm talking on this subject about, you know, that song, Be of Sin the Double Cure. Cleanse me from its guilt and power. It's not cleanse me and then leave me in the cesspool of my life that it was before. He loves us too much to do that. He cleanses us of our sin, but he empowers us to live righteously so I can be free from the thing I hated. Who wanted to live that way? I didn't want to live that way. And he loves us enough that he takes us out of that. And when we don't say that to people and we don't teach that to people, we are hurting them. And we're encouraging them, don't just stay in that sin and live that way. And you don't need to. You've been empowered by God. Thanks be to God that though Christians were slaves to sin, they wholeheartedly obeyed the pattern of teaching, he says, in an odd phrasing. He says, the pattern of teaching into which they were thereby delivered is the sense. That through obeying the pattern of teaching, they were delivered into it. In other words, they obeyed that standardized body of instruction. When he speaks of a pattern of teaching, which is the gospel. You know, everybody doesn't have their own gospel. You know, there is a cut standard. There is a standard of instruction. There is a body of truth. And having obeyed that standard of instruction, which is the gospel, they obeyed that. And as a result, they entered into that teaching. They were delivered into it. And they received its accompanying blessing. Specifically, they were freed from sin and enslaved to righteousness. They were freed from sin and enslaved to righteousness. Christian freedom is not autonomous self-direction. That's what we think of freedom. I'm on the throne. I got nobody asking anything of me or demanding anything. I'm on the throne. But Christian freedom is not autonomous self-direction, but deliverance. It's freedom from those enslaving powers that would prevent us from becoming what God intends us to be. That's Christian freedom. It is not, I'm the king of the world. I rule and call the shots and live the way I want. It's, I'm free from those powers that hinder me from being what God would have me be. Paul explains, by the way, that little parenthetical there at the beginning of verse 19. I think the idea there, he explains that his use of slavery in speaking about the Christian relationship with God is merely an analogy or an image necessitated by the weakness of human understanding. It's not intended to convey the negative aspects of secular slavery, you know, like fear of abuse and confinement and all that kind of thing. It's simply used to make the point that God is a master who requires absolute and unquestioned obedience. See, so I think that's how that functions in there when he mentions the idea of slavery there. But he says that just as, hope I got this point in the right way, just as before we were Christians, we offered ourselves as slaves to uncleanness and lawlessness, which led to increasing lawlessness. So now we must offer ourselves as slaves to righteousness. Why is this even a question? This is who we are. This is what we're called to be, how we're to live, what you're to expect from me and what I'm to expect from you, is that we are to be slaves of righteousness. That is how we're to conduct ourselves, which leads, he says, to increasing sanctification, living that is increasingly God-centered and world-renouncing. That's this. That's my little thing. You see, the slope. I'm being sanctified. I understand the way the journey goes, but do you see, I'm being sanctified. I'm being transformed. It's an upward trend to the image of Jesus. Now, we can and must serve righteousness because when we were slaves of sin, we ignored God's righteous demands, and as a result, we did things of which we're now ashamed, things that end in death. Now, I don't know about you, but I can relate to that. Some of you were raised much better than I was. Some of you didn't live the life I lived. But who can, you know, where's my brother? I know he can amen me on this. You know, lived away of things that you're now ashamed. See, things that wind up resulting in death. You see, this is what Paul says here. But now, having been freed from sin and enslaved to God, our conduct leads to increasing holiness, leads to being God-centered, world-renouncing, and the end result of which is eternal life that is realized at the consummation. That's it. That's how we've been brought. We have this foretaste of glory. We live to God's glory through the power of the Spirit. We're transformed, and then we will live forever, completely sanctified, resurrected persons in an eternity that is mind-blowing. There's no promise like it. For he says, for if you serve sin, the wage it pays is death. That's what you get. You're going to go work for this guy. And he says, here, yeah, you go ahead and you serve me. And what do I have for you in the end? Death. That's what I'm paying. No, it's a good deal. Come work for me, and in the end, you'll get death. And as Grant Osborne says, death is here, both physical death that ends earthly life and the eternal death that follows, though the latter is primary. Okay? But if you serve God, he gives the gift of eternal life and all that entails in Jesus Christ our Lord. So the Lord says, listen, this is what I call you to. You know, I care. I love you too much to have you wallow in this kind of thing. And I'm here. I've redeemed you and saved you, and I've changed you, and I've given you power, and you're to live to my glory. And in the end, I've got something for you. And it is eternal life in that perfect reality. You see, that perfect reality where there's no hidden agendas. There's just pure love. I never have to worry about somebody's motive. Are they trying to get over on me? It's just pure, I know it's love I can count on. You see? Now, who doesn't want to live that way? I do. And that's the promise. But that's not the promise. Sin gives death. God gives eternal life. And yeah, I heard that bell. Thanks for coming.